Welcome, everybody. We'd like to get the program started now. We're very honored that you could join us for this very special event featuring the incomparable Hugh Johnson. Before I introduce Hugh and his interlocutor for the evening, I'll say just a few words about the library that is bringing you this event today. The UC Davis University Library is the home to the best collection of materials related to winemaking and grape growing in the world. Along with the treasure trove of books and special collections, we have the papers of famous UC Davis viticulture and enology scientists such as Maynard Amerine and Harold Ono, as well as prominent figures from the wine industry like Robert Mondavi. We are very honored to now be able to add Hugh Johnson's papers to the collection, and I think it says a lot that such an important figure in the wine world as Hugh Johnson would choose a university halfway around the world to take care of his legacy. We're very, very proud to have it. The library is responsible for curating and preserving these collections for future scholars and to document the history, art, and science of the wine industry for future students and scholars here at UC Davis and around the world. Beyond the collections I've mentioned, we're also collecting current research going on at UC Davis to make that available through online research portals and make it easier to discover what's happening here at the university now and link it to the past and the impact that UC Davis has had over many, many decades on the wine industry. During the reception, you're going to have a chance to see a selection of Hugh Johnson's papers, ably displayed right here, and also a sample of Maynard Amerine's incredible wine label collection, which we're in the process of digitizing right now and publishing on the website so that the public can help us transcribe the labels, add new information, and make them searchable from anywhere in the world. It's an incredible collection, and I encourage you to take a look at that too. These are just examples of the kinds of innovative projects underway at the library today, and I hope to be able to tell you more about those on a future occasion. But now I need to introduce our distinguished speakers. Interviewing Hugh Johnson tonight is Professor Tom Penny. Tom is an emeritus professor of English literature at Pomona College, and very well known for his scholarship and about 24 books on George Eliot, Lord Macaulay, and Rudyard Kipling. But Tom has also published a number of well-known books concentrating on the history of wine in the United States, focused on who did what, when, and how for America as a whole. His books include A History of Wine in America from the Beginnings to Prohibition, and a second volume on Prohibition to the Present. We're very fortunate to have Tom here tonight as our expert interlocutor. The subject of his interview is, of course, our featured guest, Hugh Johnson. Hugh is a British author known to all of you very well, who's been writing about wine since 1960. Among many other accomplishments, he was a featured writer for a variety of Condé Nast publications and editor of Wine and Food. In 1971, he published what is considered the first significant attempt to map the world's wine regions, The World Atlas of Wine. I could probably go on all night about Hugh, but since I'm sure you'd rather hear from him himself, please join me in welcoming Tom Penny and Hugh Johnson.
Shall we begin at the beginning?
That's too far back.
Your first book is called Simply Wine. This might be about anything or everything in wine.
What was your idea for it?
Well, I think that four-letter words were always popular. And that was my favorite four-letter word. I was completely greenhorn. I love wine, and I've already started scratching some kind of living by writing. I thought there is no book of the kind I really want. The books that exist at the moment are either too scholarly, too superficial, they don't really go to the heart of it, they don't say why is wine a wonderful thing. All the dimensions, all the things it can bring to your life. So I said, well, okay, I'll tell them. And that was where I set off from.
And you got a good response?
Very good. It wasn't easy, by the way, to get anyone to publish it, because I started going around to publishers in 1965. Julia and I had just got married. I'd just given up paid employment to thrill her parents. I had to get a publisher's advance to be able to do what I needed to do, which was to go to the vineyards, which I hadn't been to. I just thought I knew something about them. So I went around looking for £1,000 advance. No dice. They just said, if you want to write about one, surely you know about it already. You don't need research. I mean, just go on, write what you need. I had to travel. And I asked the editor, a well-known magazine editor in London, Mark Boxer, I said, any ideas who might want to publish me? He said, yes, no problem. My friend Jocelyn has just had the biggest success ever for a cookbook. And there was an American writer actually called Robert Carrier, and he had written a book, lavishly illustrated, called Great Dishes of the World. And it was the buzz of London that he had sold 30 or 40,000 copies. It was the first coffee table cookbook, really. And Mark said, you just say you want to do the wine equivalent. And I got away with it.
You say in your memoir, The Life at Court, that you don't care for the label critic, but you do say that you very much like what the French call you, which is a vulgar visiteur, a vulgarizer. Would you explain that, please?
Well, I love vulgar, it's up to And it's all about the Vulgate. It was the first time that most people could read the Bible, after all. It's all about vulgus, the people. And a writer is nothing without a reader. And it's always been the first thing in my head, whatever I'm writing about, who's going to read this? And what do they want to know? So to be a vulgarizer to me is nothing to be ashamed of at all. It's going out there and not preaching, I hope, but certainly getting people to pay attention.
I looked up the word in my French dictionary. It means something like spreading knowledge.
Spreading knowledge.
Would that be fair to say?
And I hope entertaining at the same time.
Ah, yes, I forgot to. Speaking of critics, you don't follow the current practice of scoring wines as though they were high school exams. This wine is an 87, this one is 89, this one is only 75. So on. What's wrong with that?
How long have you got? Now, where I first heard about this funny scoring system was I was having a meeting in New York with my publisher, a guy called Dan Green, and he said, Hugh, before you go, have a look at this manuscript. Well, it was actually a galley proof. And I read these very exciting tasting notes with the most extravagant expressions of the flavors of the wine, all the oodles of fruit. And I said, well, this is terrific. And this chap is passionate. He knows what he tastes well. I said, but what are all these funny numbers down the side of the page? He said, they're the scores. I said, what? The scores. I said, well, this chap, Robert Barker, what else does he score? Does he score his friends and his family? I said, you can't score one. It just is not possible. Well, I was obviously completely wrong because everybody does. I am the only person who can't. And I really can't. I mean, I've thought about it a lot. Maybe I'm innumerate, well, that's for sure. But things don't come to me in numbers. And if I think to myself, and believe me, I try, is this wine an 85 or 86 or 91 or something? I haven't the first idea. I don't know what I'm trying to say about it. Am I trying to say that I like it, I like it, I love it, it moves me in some way, it refers to some place, it reminds me of some person, it is part of a tradition, and it tastes like that before, but because everyone wants Burgundy to taste like Burgundy, for example. And in that case, what am I? You know, am I doing it, giving it a high mark for being typical? Or for being original? You know, we're in a fantasy world. There's no such thing as marking a subject as subtle and deep and multifaceted as wine. It reaches into every part of our Western culture. It has, well, I don't need to explain all this to people like you, but the one thing you can't do with it is give it a numerical score. And I've noticed, because I go to tastings where people do this, and in Britain, the professional scoring system, which is current, is out of 100. And I look at people's scores and I think, well, they're all somehow or other, they're between 16 and 17. And well, what does that tell you? So I do actually have a scoring system of my own, and the bottom score in it is one sip. There's one sniff, there's one sniff. Because one sniff, it could tell you everything you want to know. I don't want to go any further with it tomorrow. If you take a second sniff, it means, oh, possibilities, or, I can't believe it was that bad. Then you go off the sip, same idea, you're going a little further in, and second sip, right, interested. Well, a glass means you're thirsty, you're looking around for something better, and there isn't anything. It's an expression of something, but if you have a second glass of that wine, that is thumbs up. And it gets more serious, obviously, if you order a second bottle. You really find something you like. Now, this is realistic. This is proper scoring. I know that the editor of a Swiss magazine, who has tasting sessions with his team of tasters, and they will have a test bench, and they'll have 25 Chiantis or whatever it is for the morning's work, and then they all go and have sit down and have lunch. And he puts all the bottles in the middle of the table, and then he has a measure, and he measures how many centimeters of wine have gone. You can imagine which is the winner. So this is it's the hedonism principle. But to me, it's the real one. If you like it, it's good.
How are you going to commercialize this? The sniff scale.
In reality, when I am going through a world wine and the possibility of buying them, I used to do for British Airways. It was the first time along the test bench, it was very simple. It was either thumbs up, thumbs down, or a sideways thumb, which meant must go back and look at that one because it must be either thumbs up or thumbs down. So there's a score out of 3, if you like, or 2.
You also say that wine is judged. If you leave out the context in which you have the wine, you've left out not everything, but at least half the pleasure.
Oh, yes. More than half. Oh, yes. Most of it, really.
We can score it.
It's the internal context, what the wine has to say internally about its position in the world, and the external, very obvious context about where you are, is a pleasant temperature in the room, somebody lovely to talk to, and all the things that are putting you into good condition to be appreciating anything, not just wine.
Right.
With the wine also contributing to that.
This is why good wine is not travel.
It's maybe it's the people.
You speak of a wine revolution and say that wine today is speaking in new idioms, livelier in many cases, and more persuasive than the old language. What are some of the important new things in your judgment?
Well, when I wrote that, I was thinking that in many ways, wine has been in a rut or in ruts created by history and custom and commerce and everything else. And it's much easier to sell something that is well understood, which has been sold before, people recognize the name and so on. But in modern times, that really is no longer the case. case. It's no good relying on the old formulae, if you like, to get people excited and interested. You have to go off in a new direction, and even if that new direction is scoring out of 100, that certainly got people interested. I was thinking of things like historical or regional grape varieties whose very existence has been forgotten. And take parts of Italy, which is maybe the richest country for variety of grapes, for an incredible variety of different terroirs, aspects, soils, and everything else. In many cases, I think small farmers would have been pushed to say what the grapes in their vineyard were. And this also makes me think, how did we arrive at the conventions which ruled the wine world for so long? At what point in troubled history did anyone in Burgundy have the leisure to confirm that the Pinot Noir was the best grape you could grow, to find the best Pinot Noir? This is an activity of leisure, not just being a farmer scratching a living. So somehow or other, all this research, trial and error, has been fitted in, which fascinates me. And then with a more leisurely age, and Burgundy is a case where there's a historical moment where there was, if you can call being a monk, a leisurely pursuit, and it wasn't for the Cistercians, because they, many of them died of overwork at 30, and they worked very, very hard. They had something that was worth concentrating on, because they were making a luxury good that didn't exist previously. And then the Dukes of Burgundy were very, very happy to claim that this was their property, and that only they had a wine of this quality. And I'd like to think of the time when, however rich and powerful you were, unless you felt like going to conquer an enemy and taking his stuff, if you wanted to offer a present, an important gift, what was it? The guy already had all the armor he could wear, all the furs he could wrap himself up in, all the jewelry he could offer, and so on. So what on earth was there that was unique, totally special, and totally belonged in Burgundy? Well, it was red Burgundy. And so the Dukes of Burgundy were able to send barrels of this wine. And everyone who tasted it said, oh my goodness, I had no idea there was pleasure like that. And I reckon it's part of the reason why Pope Clement moved the papacy from Rome to Avignon. He wanted to be nearer the wines of mine. Did that answer the question? new Indians, yes. Well, I mean, it has a lot to do with what people are asking of wine. And flavors that they didn't know were even related. I mean, recently, Greece has come right into fashion. And we are learning to say Hadjorgikiko and Asiatiko and all these Greek grape names. And discovering that there are flavors out there that were not even hinted at in the classical times when all fine wine came from France. But it's true. France invented fine wine. It was refined in France. And people say, oh, well, there must be a great wine history in Spain, for example, and in Italy. Well, you were going to look for it, because fine wine was not on the agenda. It was only in France that fine wine was really on the agenda. And I think we must be grateful to all those researchers over all those centuries.
And the present ones. Well, I have a question about sweet wine. Are you prepared for that? Why do people go about saying that they don't like sweet wines? And why is the production of so-called sweet wine or fortified wine, the production of that wine, that style of wine, has almost disappeared in this country?
Well, maybe are they the same subject, sweet wine and fortified wine? I mean, they certainly go together.
But fortified wine went seriously out of fashion, what is it, 40 years ago?
something like 50 that. Years ago. I mean, who remembers Thunderbird?
What is that bottle you're hiding there? It's absolutely true. The statistics, in fact, at the date of my World Atlas of Wine, I think in the first edition, I put graphs of the consumption, the fading away of fortified wine, and it was particularly striking in Australia, whose whole wine industry really was what they called port and sherry, and it was very largely the case here as well. Why did it go? Well, I think it's lifestyle. People didn't drink purely for the boozy effect. They became interested in wine with food, above all. I mean, it's the two together which creates a study of really fine wine. So sweet wine was sort of, if it's sweet, it's old-fashioned, boozy. Mm-hmm. I am smarter than that. I like dry wine. And then this overtook the pure sweet wine industry. I mean, the great German Auslesers, Sauternes, Tokaj, and people said, no, not interested in that. And there was a terrible slump in it. And
this is not a question on the program, but you brought it up. You're interested in Tokaj.
I am.
And is that prosperous?
It will be. Now, Tokaj is a particular case, because I was interested in it because I've got a great regard for Hungary and a very embattled, creative nation. I mean, there are only 10 million Hungarians or something in the world, but you certainly know about them. And don't go into a swing door before them, because you'll come out after. They are well able to take care of themselves. And Tokaj fetched the highest price of any wine at all in worldwide in the 17th and 18th centuries into the 19th century. There are so many references. Tokaj is the ultimate luxury, the ultimate luxury. Amazing prices. And all that went down really with the First World War, with the October Revolution. Its main markets were Russia and Poland and Eastern Europe generally. All that went with communism, and they didn't know what to do or how to sell or how to make, and then along came the communist regime, said, we'll take lots of wine. All you've got to do is send us tanker trucks of X thousand hectolitres of a fluid with this sugar content, that alcohol content, and it's got to match this colour sample. And they had no alternative but to salute. And then under the Soviet regime, they didn't even get paid in money, they got paid in tractors or something like that. And when they got the tractors, they found they were too wide to go in the vineyards. So it was not very, it was not a great moment. And I bore this in mind. And once upon a time, I went, in fact, it was 1970, I was taken on a trip to Poland and then Hungary as a journalist. And I tasted this astonishing wine in the old state cellars, the old imperial cellars in Tokaj. And that taste haunted me. I don't know how old, it was probably 100 years old. It was a wonderful dark amber color. It was, I just thought, so that is another thing wine can do. And it's lost, gone, nobody's doing it. And then it became clear in the late 1980s that communism was on the skids, on the build up to the Berlin Wall and so on. It was very clear that something was going to change in a big way. And I thought, and with a great friend of mine who's a winemaker called Peter Vindingdiers, we thought, now there's only one great wine region which is stuck behind the Iron Curtain. Why don't we go and see if we can help? So we did, and within months of the revolution, right at the beginning of 1990, we went there and we had a meeting with the with some farmers who were all part of this cooperative winery, and said, look, you can provide us with good grapes,
we'll take care of the rest. We'll find a market. And that's exactly what happened. We started something which we called the Royal Dock Isle Wine Company. And people said, why royal? And I said, because Hungary was a kingdom. It wasn't part of an empire. It was a very individual kingdom, very proud of itself. So the Royal Dock Isle Wine Company staggered. No money, no market. And then we made friends around the world. And I'm happy to say that one of those friends is in the room right now. Hello, Jack. Who found us a market right here in the USA. And we've worked a lot of shoe leather around the world. And people said, sweet wine, not interested. I used to say, well, look, when you get to the dessert course in a restaurant, why don't you say, no, no, instead of dessert, I'm going to have a glass of Dock Isle. Much better for your health. And it's not just a substitute, it's a fabulous alternative. So sweet can go forward as well, Tom.
No regrets.
All right, we'll change direction now. What advice would you give to a young person who aspires to become an authority about wine? What are some of the right things to keep in mind and some of the things to avoid? Are you ever asked?
Yes, I mean, people ask me how to get into the wine. People say, can I have your job? That's the first question. practice. And a lot of people, sometimes there's a sort of radio phone-in program like that, and lots of people say, where do I start? And I say, well, start by being happy with where you are. Don't pay too much for wine. Maybe the prices, as we all know, factor number one or number two, terrible. You're comfortable with untrousering X dollars. You're not over concerned about it, but you want a drink. And so, okay, so look at the wines that you will be comfortable with, because they cost X. And then make some comparisons. And don't expect that the first model will be the ideal model. And it's easiest to make comparisons if you buy several bottles, and you're not going to drink several bottles, so share it with friends. These are the practical factors, I think. You go out to dinner or you gather at home and you say to some friends, why don't we all each one buy a bottle of Napa Cab or something? And then we'll sit around and we say what we think about them. And before you know where you are, you've got a wine tasting and you've got a conversation going. As long as you don't go try and score them out of 100, you will find out what you think about them. And exchange knowledge, and then the next point that I would recommend is to make notes, because it's when you can verbalize it endlessly, but if you actually say to yourself now, which is the right word that expresses what I'm thinking, then first of all it makes you concentrate, and second you've got a record. So those are the simple practical things of getting into wine, as I believe, and you know, on each level they work. They may sound incredibly basic and fundamental, but I think on all levels they still work. What to avoid? Wine's over X, $100 a bottle. I mean, the other aspect of wine is the luxury goods aspect, which is important, but it's great for quality, and it draws up the quality from the top, because you can't push up quality from the bottom, you never could. On the other hand, it makes people goggle at prices and feel that they can never keep up. I think that is an awful shame.
This is my last question. Your archive, now to be part of the collection here at Davis,
appears to be largely a record of your work on your many books. What do you think that students and researchers might find particularly interesting in?
Well, Judy and I were moving house 3 years ago. And I went up into the attic. We had a large country house, and in the attic I found that I got old tea chests full of manuscripts, typescripts, and all the stuff I used to bang out on a typewriter before computers with carbon paper and all that stuff. And I couldn't bear to let them go. And I thought, well, would these be of interest? And I thought, well, yes, because they record 50 years, well, more accurately, 60 years, of one person's appreciation of wine and bringing in other people and studying different aspects of the subject, which started with, our first book was pure appreciation, the second book was based on geography, and then I tried to do an encyclopedia, which was a hard work, and then I thought, well, the history became, to start with, I wasn't interested in the history, really. But the more I found out about it, the more I thought this is an essential part of the background. Why does Burgundy taste like Burgundy? Bordeaux differently. And so I became very involved with the history, and then I made a PBS TV series about that, and so all these records built up. My researches, my manuscripts, people's comments, proofs and everything else that's involved in making books and making films. And I thought, well, I'm certainly not going to chuck this away. Where could it be kept under good conditions, where it could be available to anyone interested, and which is a wine center of real and future importance? And I thought, UC Davis, I'm not going to be interested. And then the conversation began. And I am very pleased, I mean, I must say I'm very proud, that all this labor of mine, or some of it, will fetch up in a place where I think it'll be safe and it will be available. And I hope that people will find uses for it. They'll certainly find out lots of things to avoid. And they will learn thinking about wine over decades, over generations practically, how wine knowledge and appreciation has developed in the most exciting period there's ever been in wine history, because there's been more movement in the last 50 years than in the previous thousands of years. So I think it's a worthwhile record, and I do want people to be able to use it.
I have what is not a question, but an opportunity for you to tell us something. You have more than one identity. You're a celebrated wine writer, the best-selling wine writer, and that's fair to say, is it not?
In terms of books.
But you have other interests.
Oh, I do.
Well, skip the domestic interests.
I think that, well, I just written The World Atlas of Wine, and that was in 1971, and it was a big hit, and we sold improbable numbers of books from the word go. And so my publisher, James Mitchell, said, okay, Hugh, what's your next act? You know, this is going well, so what's the next one? And I said, James, I want to write a book about trees. He said, did you say cheese? I said, cheese. He said, trees, they are not a consumer subject. And so I did have a struggle to convince anyone that a book on a really ambitious scale, the same format and lots of colour pictures and everything, looking rather like the Wine Atlas, that it was a go. And it wouldn't have been, except that a very old friend of mine was working for one of the really big paper companies, International Paper Company, and he sold those enormous great sort of toilet rolls that go into, or used to go into newspaper factories and come out of newspapers. And he said, I happen to know that they are celebrating their 75th anniversary. He said, let's go to your channel. And we did. And we said, all your customers would be so impressed, because they think you just cut down trees, you hate trees. They'd be so impressed if you gave them, for your, in celebration of your anniversary, a great big beautiful, the biggest, most beautiful book about trees. But we'll need money. I'm glad to say that the paper company bankrolled the book, and they very sensibly asked for a royalty. So it came out of my royalty, of course. And within a few years, they had their money back, and it worked. The whole program worked. And it also gave me an extraordinary interest in a wonderful subject about which I hadn't got a clue. I just loved trees, and I'd looked around for books that would deepen my appreciation and a little bit of knowledge. And rather as in the case of wine, I found the books were either too specialist or too superficial. I said, okay, here is the opening. It may be a five-letter word, but I'm going to call it trees. And that gave me a great interest in life, which I pursue all the time. And I owe a lot to the tree specialists who provided information that made it reasonably reliable, and the people who took me to their forests in the northwest and to the tree farms down in Georgia where they breed new trees to go even quicker, and met wonderful people with a very parallel life to people in the wine business. You know, we're dealing with beautiful products of nature, how to make money out of them, how to get the best out of them. A vine would be a tree if it could, it just doesn't have to.
And what about gardening?
Well, that, you know, you don't start being interested in gardening until you get a garden. And that's when Julie and I moved to the country in 1970, we were faced with a rather ambitious garden. And so I had to write a book about it, didn't I? they all group around the wonderful products of nature, really.
You didn't mention the Royal Horticultural Society.
Well, I did get tied up in that, yes. You want that story?
Yes.
Well, this was when I started my career in the magazine business. The first job I ever had was on Vogue magazine. How did I get it? The only way you could get a job on Vogue was you had to be a woman and you had to go in for the Vogue talent contest. So I didn't qualify for that. But somehow or other they took me on in the features department where all my colleagues were women. And it's quite hard work being in love with three beautiful women at the same time in the features department, and all incredibly educated and beautifully dressed and so on. I wanted to do something that they might not have thought of, which is how I came to write my first wine article. I went to the editor and said, would readers be interested in wine? She said, well, give it a go. And that was Christmas 1960. And you'll never guess what the title was. What to drink with turkey? I could have written that article 60 times. And then being a magazine man, sorry, I should try and complete the answer. Being a magazine man, I edited a fashion magazine called Queen for a while, and I was a travel editor and all sorts of things. So I learned the magazine disciplines, and it was just after the Yom Kippur War of 1970, was it three or four? Three. That everything was in crisis. Price of fuel soaring from the roof. And I was approached by the lovely chap who I made friends with. He was director of Royal Botanical Gardens at Kew, an old Scotsman called George Taylor. And he said, Hugh, he said, you know something about magazines? He said, yeah, because we've got a crisis. They want to stop. They want to give up the magazine of the Royal Horticultural Society. come and talk to us. So I went to a meeting and they said, the one, this is a very well-established, important society. And it's one way of communicating, called communicating with its members who were then known as fellows, was its journal, which was as boring as it could be, with a plain grey paper cover, practically nothing in the way of illustration.
And he said, they want to give it up. And I said, that would be great. But the only way to keep people on board is to communicate with them. And the one way you are communicating is with a magazine. So improve the magazine. And this then, that was 1975, we restarted the magazine. It's now called The Garden. And now it has 400,000 subscribers. It's also really colossal.
Well, we were promised an evening with Hugh Johnson, and it's not over yet. So now it's your turn. We have a little bit of time for you to ask questions of our honored guest, if you have any. And there's a microphone in the audience. So I'm going to give you a moment to just think about all the things you always wanted to ask Hugh Johnson, and this is your chance. We'll start up here.
Hi, good evening. And first of all, I just have to say I'm just delighted. I have a question that was a point of discussion with another wine professional recently about how wine has changed due to the globalization of everything. Now that we have immediate access to, you know, individual biscuits from South Australia and teas from India and so forth, and wines from everywhere. And so there's this ability to exchange style and information and tastings and so forth that is so much more immediate than it was 40, 50, 60 years ago when you might have started writing. Do you think that it has changed the way wine is made or the way wine is perceived by consumers?
Oh, yes, I do. The first phase of globalization, clearly, was for everything to begin to taste the same in terms of wine. And we all know how, you know, if it wasn't Chardonnay, you couldn't sell it. Everything had to match the global concepts. And that's what we're moving out of very rapidly. And this is the business of new idioms and so on, is the way that individuals can make their mark through the internet and so on. I mean, I begin to wonder whether books have any future, and my kind of books, because all that information is available. The future they have is because you have to organize information. It's never just saying it's all out there somewhere. Somebody's got to draw it together. But I think this is wonderful, and I think it starting all the new ideas like so-called natural wine, where you let it bubble away and see what happens instead of controlling it. All of which, to me, is positive. I mean, I don't think there ought to be any constraints. I think it's the most exciting time we've ever seen.
Out of all the parts of your career, your job, from the tasting to the writing to the seeing the reaction of your work, which one was your most favorite, most cherished? And secondly, I think you touched on this during your presentation, but I think wine has become, over time, very sort of unapproachable in a way to some people, a little bit intimidating. How do you think, as individuals in the wine industry, and in particular, some of us who are students, how do you think we can take away that intimidation factor and bring wine back to the human roots where it came from?
Well, thank you. Part one, referring to me and my enjoyment and so on, it's the writing. I mean, I don't have any, frankly, no qualifications to talk about life, except experience. So, I mean, what I bring to it, if anything, is simply being able to write in a way that people like reading. So, part two, the snobbism, wine boorishness and snobbism. And, you know, my standards are higher than your standards and all that kind of thing. Or I'm richer than you. I think this is, how do we get rid of it? How do we conquer it? Well, not by scoring wines out of 100, I'm sorry to keep on with my hobby laws, but I do think the idea that something is inherently better, bully for me, I can buy it, is just crushing for all the people who can't buy it. So appreciation is something that has to be learnt, but not top down in the way that somebody is preaching to you and telling you that something is superior. I mean, I don't know how to improve on that, but I think it's the only answer. I find that a lot of the wine publications today are unbearably snobbish. And you know, snobbish is bad in any part of life, but wine is supposed to be about enjoyment.
What makes you happy about American wine?
What makes you happy about it? Well, it might have been different from the wines that were made for people like me in centuries in the past. You know, it was the English bourgeoisie who set the pattern of the tastes of wine in the past. And there were wines that we were directly responsible for, like claret, like Bordeaux. I mean, it was part of the English kingdom for 300 years. So we grew up together, and then port and champagne, we started asking for glasses, I mean, bubbles. There was a discussion whether the English actually invented champagne, but we won't pursue that yet. So we come to a totally different culture of wine with none of the same preconceptions, really, basically, and asking different things of it, different responses. That is one of the reasons why I think that the new era, which I'm trying to define, is super positive. Because think of all the new grape varieties that found a home here in California, which were not suited in many cases to the old world, and think of the enthusiasm that they're received with. And you could also think of the flavors of the Napa Valley, the flavors of Sonoma, the possibilities. I mean, we went up the North Sonoma coast this time last year and found a world of wine that had no idea it existed. And the means to pursue this, that's what's so wonderful. The audience, which is all ears for something new, how can you not be excited by all this?
Hi, I'm sure you're aware there's a lot of discussion about the different types of closures for wines. Are you a screw top guy?
I twisted off for you. Yeah. Very much so. I think that the New Zealanders have got it just right. And if you approach it analytically, how long a wine is going to wait before it's over. Somebody did a survey in Australia to what was the average length of time between purchase and consumption of a bottle of wine. It was between 15 and 20 minutes. So why do you need a call? But you know, there are plenty of experiments. Will wine keep long term under a screw cap? What is the lining material in the top of the screw cap? Can that be improved? Can the aesthetics of the screw cap be improved? But it is perfectly quaint that the way that a wine bottle is conventionally stopped now is with a piece of tree bark. Because, you know, back in the 17th century, what were the alternatives? We've got alternatives, and they are potentially much better. And I'm fed up with my corkscrew.
Hugh
I'll ignore the Australian joke, but most of us in the room weren't even into wine when you wrote the first book. Could you tell us your first visit to California and some of the people that you met? Two or three examples.
Well, my first visit to California was when I was, before I went to university, I took a sort of gap year, and I arrived in San Francisco in 1957. How long ago is that? And conceived a strong desire to come back. And then I started to get interested in wine, which I wasn't. And there was another reason, actually, which was a wonderful wine merchant called Otto Loew, who ought to be in the history books and ought to have a plaque on. Who supplied wine to the people who became the medical friends of wine, I guess, in San Francisco and Bay Area. And these were enlightened amateurs who obviously charged their patients enough to be able to afford the best wines. And they used to have their holidays in Europe and began visiting regions, got passionate about particularly Moselle Riesling. They became the best specialists on it, and wines of Burgundy and so on. And so they invited this great doctor there to come to California. And he fell in love with the wines he found here, and there was not a great variety. And so he then was invited by me and my contemporaries at Cambridge University to give us a tasting. And so when I was a stripling of 17 or something, I was tasting Louis Martini, BV, Italian Swiss Colony, Christian Brothers, all these things, and becoming fascinated. And they became familiar names. We were ahead of our time, a long way ahead of our time, but that gave me a real reason and interest in being there. And then I came back in 1966, when I was working on my first book, and I was didn't have any much in the way of contacts and things, but I went to see the names that I really knew about, and then I read that book in almost total ignorance. I mean, it has some references, but it's not very good. Then I was more serious when I came to do the World Atlas of Wine, and I had to know. And the thing about making maps is you can't leave anything out. You know, in the Middle Ages, they could just write here be dragons. which you could apply to the Mayakamsh Mountains, but I never. I had to know what I was talking about. And I went to a wine institute, and they introduced me to a lovely chap called Bob Thompson. I wonder how many people in the room know Bob Thompson. He was the most charming and brilliant guy that I could have had. And we are still great friends. We saw him today before yesterday, 190 years later. And he and I wrote a book together in 1975, which was intended to be the first consumer's guide of the era, the guide to all the wineries. Unfortunately, we were sued by a winemaker for a frightening amount of money for what he claimed was misrepresentation of his winery. He said we cost him a national distributorship, and he was cross. But when publishers hear about lawsuits, they pulp the book. You know, they don't want to get involved in that kind of thing. And so we pretty much lost the book. There are copies around, but not very many.
I have one.
You have? Very good hands. it was a respectable book. We only got out of this and stayed out of jail because the wine editor of the Los Angeles Times was, his name escapes me, a lawyer.
Nathan Groman.
Nathan Groman. Thank you, Gil. And I told the story to Nathan Groman, and he said, wait a minute, that's not right. I got to write. So he wrote to Gallo, Martini, Johnson, and so on. He said, one of your number is tried in jail. The first writers who've tried to do justice to the industry for a long while. Nobody else is going to come and try, you know, to stop it. So they did. They all said, go away. But it was too late because the publishers had already junked the book. There we are. What was the question? So that was the beginning, as far as I was concerned.
Has your definition of terroir evolved over time? Where is it now today? Your definition of terroir, has it evolved over time? And
once more for the microphone.
It's almost terroir, its definition, I think it's almost lost of definition. Because are you talking about a French concept, the word terroir? Are you talking about the way it's been applied? I think it's a word that people avoid these days. And if they want to refer to the soil aspect of things, they use this equally ambiguous word, minerality. Minerality is a buzzword now, and every wine you want to sell is minerally. I think most people use it as a way of not saying acidic, because acid doesn't sound nice. Last week's wine writers seminar in the Napa Valley, one of the sessions was devoted to minerality, and it was very enlightening, but on a technical level, really. I still think it's among consumers, it's something best avoided. In fact, in the next edition of my little pocket wine book, which is, God help me, the 40th, I decided to just leave it out. And I said in the foreword of this book, you won't find mineral in here, because nobody agrees on what it means. So let's find another word for each time we want to use it. Terroir remains. Well, I tried to define it. I really had to, for the world atlas of wine. That's what it was about. And I took it to mean all the obvious physical things about soil drainage, aspect, hours of sunshine, prevailing wind direction, you can go on and on and on about that, shelter. But also the cultural intention of the winemaker. Because he sets out to, in most cases, to conform to a local tradition. And he wants his wine to be recognizable as X or Y, because that's where he grows it, and he's proud of the name. And that to me, so it's not just agricultural, it's cultural in all those ways. There's been a big debate recently. Not really a debate. In Burgundy, they were very keen to get United Nations, what's it called, heritage status, UN heritage status for Burgundy. Because Tokaj actually was, I think, the first wine region to get a UN heritage status. Very pleased with that. Champagne went for one. They couldn't just say, we've got pretty vineyards and we make nice wines. They said the thing that is really special about Champagne is the cellars, their nature and their function and everything else. So they got UN heritage status. So the Burgundians getting a little bit envious here. What we have to offer is the concept of the klima. The klima is a patch of land upon the Côte d'Or which offers a little terroir. So I was part of a conference about this. We tried to persuade each other that we were both that the klima was important to get, important enough to get UN heritage status, and it did. Just latterly, just the other day, practically. And I was asked to talk about the concept of terroir around the world and how far it had got in, for example, California. And that was difficult to talk about because people didn't talk about the soil. We were just discussing earlier today, when did the word soil first crop up as a study at UC Davis? Remarkably recently.
industry's increasing concern for the growing popularity of the craft beer industry.
I missed the last word, sorry.
Craft beer.
Beer.
Craft beer.
Oh. Most winemakers I know love it. It's what you have at the end of a long, tiring tasting.
That seems like a great note to end on. Before we depart, I need to thank Rick Minderman and Daryl Cordy very much for filming the evening's program so we can all enjoy it again. And the library staff and volunteers who have worked very hard to make this event happen. And of course, please join me in thanking our wonderful speakers, Tom and Hugh.